Hello, everyone. I'm glad you're here with us this week. This is The Good Word. I'm Pastor John. And this is the week of Valentine's Day. Yesterday was Valentine's Day. And my wife and I sat here at this table having a nice little meal. And we had some of this Bailey's strawberry cream. I've never had it before. It's good stuff. And a nice little meal together. We don't usually like to go out to restaurants. We'd rather just be home, avoid the crowds, and just kind of enjoy time together. And we had some fun conversations. One of the things we were talking about was romance songs from our growing up, from the late 70s and early 80s. That's kind of our coming of age era where we were teenagers and middle school and high school. And we realized a lot of the songs, especially the songs I remember, they weren't really love songs, although I call them love songs. They were more like longing for love songs, breakup songs more, like Randy Van Warmer, You Left Me Just When I Needed You Most, or Eric Carmen, All By Myself, or tons of Air Supply songs, Lying Alone With My Head On The Phone, Thinking Of You Till It Hurts, or all kinds of songs like that. Yeah, more longing for love than really about love. One of the artists we were talking about was the artist Meatloaf, and some of his iconic love songs. Now, he passed away a few weeks ago. Some of you may not even know who he is. You've got to be roughly mine and Kathy's age, maybe a little older, maybe a little bit younger, to kind of know who Meatloaf was. In fact, my daughter had no clue when he passed away who he was, and saw a posting on Facebook from one of her friend's moms who said, "Farewell, my beloved Meatloaf." And she's like, "What was that? Did somebody like burn the meatloaf or drop the meatloaf?" That was kind of funny. But when we reminded her of some of the songs, she remembered. And he didn't have too many songs, but he had a handful of songs that were pretty iconic for those of us who grew up in the late 70s and early 80s, came of age during that. He had the song Paradise by the Dashboard Light. He had the song You Took the Words Right Out of My Mouth. The song I Would Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That. And the song that I've really been thinking about since he passed away a few weeks and wanted to kind of reflect with you on today is his song Two Out of Three Ain't Bad.
And all I can do is keep on telling you I want you.
I want you.
I need you.
I need you.
But there ain't no way I'm ever gonna love you. Now don't be sad.
Don't be sad,
'cause two out of three.
I want you, I need you, but there ain't no way I'm ever gonna love you. So don't be sad, baby. Two out of three ain't bad. I've been thinking about that. There ain't no way I'm ever gonna love you. What does that mean? And what does that mean in terms of Christian love? We're to love everybody, even our enemies. So who is unworthy of love? Who can't be loved? What does that mean, Meatloaf? And of course, that's not an original idea with Meatloaf, right? He's just tapping into a sentimentality that's already in our culture. You hear it all the time, right? In dating relationships. Well, I'm just not, you're a nice person. You're a nice guy. I'm just not in love with you. You know what? You're a really nice lady and you're so good to our kids and you're a good person. I just don't love you anymore. We hear that, right? As if somehow there's just something in us that says, I'll just never be able to love you. What does that mean? And is that even true? So I want to talk about love a little bit today, and I want to talk about it specifically in the context of marriage and relationships. Now, hold on before you turn me off right here. I know some of you are single, some of you are divorced, some of you are widowed, some of you are in very difficult marriages, and I understand all of that, but please hear me out. I think everybody can learn from this. And some of you may think, well, I'll never be in a romantic relationship again, so why should I listen? Because you're going to have a friend or a child or someone who's going to come to you in crisis and say, I just don't love him anymore. I just don't love her anymore. And our culture's answer is to sever the relationship, go your separate ways, because we're out of love. I don't understand that. Let's talk a little bit about what the Bible says about love. One of the problems often in our culture is the way we use words. And you've heard me say it before. Romantic love, it's not the same as biblical love. Now, there's a place for romantic love, and let me talk about that in just a second. But biblical love is so much bigger. It's wider, it's deeper, it's broader, it is stronger and more powerful. Now, if you're in a married relationship, there's a place for romance, of course. And there's a place in the Bible for romantic love. The Bible has three words for love: eros, philos or philos, and agape. Eros is this kind of love. It's erotic love. And I don't just mean like pornographic erotic love. That's how we use the word. It's, I'm attracted to you. I'm sexually attracted to you. I'm into you. You make me smile when I'm around you. I love your body. I love your personality. I love your energy. I love what you love to do. I just love being with you. That's that kind of romantic love. I actually think that's the love that Meatloaf is talking about, and a lot of people talk about when they say, I just don't love you anymore. I'm not turned on by you anymore. I don't enjoy being with you anymore. We used to have interest, but now we don't. That's a big part of marriage. And if you're married, I encourage you to try to keep that alive. But please, and hear me well, if that's all your love is based on, then you're going to end up singing Meatloaf songs. I want you, I need you, but ain't no way I'm ever going to love you. I'm just not turned on sexually by you anymore. I'm not enjoying your presence anymore. But there's more to love than that. The second word for love is philos. That's a little broader. And marriage should have this love too. Philos is friendship love. Philadelphia is after Philos. It's the city of brotherly love. It's just that familial friendship love. You should be friends with your mate. You should enjoy just sharing life together. And maybe the romance is there sometimes, maybe it's not, but it's bigger than that, right? And I'll be honest with you, there's been seasons in mine and Kathy's life when we've been like, you know, we're kind of like roommates, and we're kind of like running a business together called the Barber Family, especially when you're in the thick of raising kids. You have to make effort to kind of bring the romance back in a little bit. But it's okay. It's not always there, but it's important. But that friendship, that partnership is so important too. And to keep that going, even if those desires aren't there, we can work together. We can work this out. We can live together. We can support one another. That's important. That's philos. That's brotherly love. But there's an even greater love, and that's agape. And agape is the love that God, that Christ has for us. It's a love that not only has warm feelings about us, it's a love that not only enjoys our company, and it's flattering that God would enjoy our company, we certainly enjoy his company, it's a love that would lay its life down for another. And my friends, in the marital relationship, you're going to have that kind of love too. The scripture this leads me to is Ephesians chapter 5. And here Paul is talking about marital love. And there are instructions for Christian households, for kids and families and those who live in the household. And in verse 21 of chapter 5, he says, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. We are to yield our desires, our will, our ways to the other. I keep pointing over here because I'm imagining Kathy sitting across from me. I'm going to say, Kathy, your needs are more important than mine. Having it your way is more important than having it my way. I am to submit and surrender my desires, my needs, my will to hers. Now, it doesn't have to be in this like extreme way that just sucks all the life out of me. It's submitting to one another. But she says back to me, no, your needs and what you want is more important. And then we have this beautiful discussion that's in love, right? Our culture would say, oh no. John, you're going to surrender your dreams, your will for her? That's crazy. You're going to miss everything out that you were meant to be. But Jesus says, no, there's a different way. If I love my life, I'm actually going to lose it. Our culture says, love your life or you're going to lose it. Jesus says, if you love your life, you are going to lose it. But if you lay your life down and surrender to God's will and put the other before yourself, you will actually find life. Listen to Jesus here. Listen to his wisdom. So Ephesians 5, husbands and wives, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your husbands as you do to the Lord. Now that's not about a power trip or about being oppressed or if men have control over their wives. No, it's an open, free, we're submitting to one another, and it's out of your own free will, out of your own power and autonomy, saying, I will do it your way. Do it out of love. Do it out of reverence for Christ. And the husband has an equally, if not perhaps even more challenging role to say, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Wow. Wow. I'm to love my wife, Kathy, as Christ loved his church. Christ went to the cross. Christ suffered so much and died so much so that we could have life and be set free. How much suffering am I to endure as a husband, as a man? I don't think I could suffer that much. Bring it on. Now, I'm not saying that's easy. I'm not saying that's right. Sometimes it's really hard. But we are to have that kind of love for one another. A tough love, a sacrificial love. And again, in marriage, not to listen to the world. And this is why I'm so glad and hope some of you that are single or widowed or grandparents are still listening to me, because I think our kids, our grandkids come to us the same thing. I'm just not in love anymore. I want to do something more with my life. I feel empty. I feel hollow. And so we think because the eros is gone that it's over. But we're really missing out. If we will listen to Christ and hang in there and learn to love in a sacrificial way, eros comes and goes throughout the seasons of a long marriage. Philos can come and go too. There can be times you feel really close and on the same page, and other times you go through seasons, whether your mate's going through a mood or a change or whatever's going on, that you don't feel very close, and you're just hanging in there out of obedience to Christ. But I think, and you hear this a lot from people whose marriages have gone the distance, if you hang in there and you sacrifice and you love and you do it, sometimes you can't do it out of any feelings for that other person, but you do it for Christ, you will bear the good fruit in the end. Our culture gives up on love too easily. It has too shallow of an idea of love. Let's lift our idea of love higher. Let's never be caught saying, I want you, I need you, but there ain't no way I'm ever going to love you. In Christ, I will always love you. I will be committed to you, Kathy, till death do us part. So let me leave you this week with another song, with a better song. It came out a few years after, but is roughly from the same era. Some of you may remember it. Another top 40 hit. Love, lift us up where we belong. Believe it or not, that song was originally a gospel song, and they just tweaked the lyrics a little bit to make it a more secular song. I actually love the gospel version even better by BB and CC Winans. But if you put the two together, and many of you know the song, it makes sense. And that's my prayer for you this week. That's the good word this week. Lord, lift us up. Lift up our vision and our view of love from this shallow, sentimental, so easily broken and lost view of love. Lift it up to where it belongs.